Thank you for joining. My name is Malcolm Gomsall. I'm the Grant Thornton Chief Operating Officer, but much more importantly than that today, I am the leadership team sponsor for the LGBTQIA plus community. So my job is to make sure that the team and the community get everything that they need to make Grant Thornton the most inclusive place possible to work. Particular passion for me is areas of non-visible inclusion, issues around neurodiversity, social mobility, and LGBTQIA in particular are areas where I'm particularly focused personally as well as professionally. So I would self-describe myself, or the blind or the visually impaired. How would I self-describe myself? I was once very kindly compared to David Ginola, who is a French footballer. I think that's an especially kind suggestion. I would say more accurately, mid-50s, gentle beard. Today, a red, blue and white checked casual shirt. And I am going today to chair this session. My role is to introduce our three panellists. But just before I do that, a little bit on why we are holding this event. The backdrop is plainly where we are in UK society. Perception and treatment of trans people today is a backdrop we can't ignore. But what we really want to do today is focus and get centre of the room trans voices to give space to them to shed some light on what it really means to be and to live as a trans person in the workplace. So, if I can start by introducing the first of our panellists, we've got Shiva, Tate and Robin. If I could introduce Shiva and ask Shiva to tell her a little bit of names and pronouns, etc. For maybe 3 or 4 minutes, if that's okay.
Hello, everyone. My name is Shiva Raichandani. Thank you so much for having me here. I am a South Asian Indian brown person. I'm seated in front of a white wall. I've got a purple jacket, black t-shirt inside, red lips, purple earrings, short brown hair. And yeah, that's me. My pronouns are they, them. I am non-binary. A little about me. I was born in Hong Kong. I was raised in Indonesia, and then I studied in India before moving to the UK to pursue a postgraduate degree, then stayed back. I started out as a professional dancer, teaching and performing Bollywood dance and Indian classical dance, Bharatanatyam. I was a semi-finalist on Britain's Got Talent many moons ago, and I have now transitioned into filmmaking. During my daytime, I'm a consultant in the entertainment industry around diversity, equity, and inclusion. How do we make the content and the media that we have a bit more inclusive, a bit more diverse, how we can bring more voices and just color into everything that we consume on a day-to-day out there. And I create films. I've got recently a Netflix documentary that's out called Peach Paradise, which shines a light on the spectrum of Asian drag that we have in the UK, and a community that doesn't often get a spotlight in the mainstream media. And another film called Queer Paribar on Channel 4 that can be watched. It is around a South Asian romance, full of trans and non-binary characters. A lot of my work tends to sort of center the narratives of the British Asian community with a queer lens to sort of challenge the stereotypes and representation that is there out there for us, and to create a space for more trans and non-binary Asian people in the UK to tell their own stories. So yeah, that's me. Thank you so much for having me here.
Thank you. Tate, I wonder if you could introduce yourself.
Hi, everyone. Thank you for having me. So my name is Tate Smith. My pronouns are he, him. I'm a white male with short brunette hair, and today I'm wearing a white and black striped jumper. So I'm an openly transgender man, and I've been transitioning coming up to just 4 years now on testosterone. I had top surgery 2 years ago, luckily. So day to day, I work as a legal secretary, but I'm better known for being a trans activist and public speaker. I typically do lunch and learns and panels like these, where I touch upon educating others really about the trans male lived experience and giving visibility to trans men, because I really think that's lacking, whilst also debunking common myths surrounding trans people and highlighting issues specific to the male lived experience, like toxic masculinity and male privilege. Really happy to be here, and thanks a lot for having me.
Thank you. Robin, I wonder if you could introduce yourself. Robin, you're on mute at the moment.
Just to demonstrate my complete incompetence with technology, I regard anything beyond a fountain pen as advanced technology. So I'm still, as far as I can tell, Britain's only male to female trans discrimination barrister, transitioned 12 years ago now. Today I'm borrowing a room from Bart's Hospital, where I'm lurking today, and I'm trying to fit in amongst the medics by wearing a not particularly well-ironed t-shirt with Cambridge emblazoned across the front of it. The story behind which is complicated, but not for today. I've been involved in quite a number of trans cases, an increasing number of trans cases in that decade since I transitioned, and as trans has become much more controversial than it was. One of the things I think we're going to talk about is potentially the toxicity of social media. And I was recently described as the fat white bloke in a bad wig pretending to be a woman in a dress. Which rather expresses how social media operates. The one thing that was quite surprising about that is that Tony and Guy in Taunton were really surprised, because it's all my own hair, and Tony and Guy were really upset about the bad wig comment. I didn't know about it until they emailed me back. So I tend to be quite visible, and I'm afraid to say I think the people who are not supportive of trans identities therefore find a necessity to attack people like me, but I like taking the fight to the enemy, so I'm not entirely unhappy about that. It's nice what it allows you to do. I gave evidence to the Women and Equality Select Committee in the House of Commons on the 31st of January, and two anti-trans activists, who I won't distinguish by naming, sat behind me giggling and laughing whenever they didn't like something I was some of the evidence I was giving. And the great thing about that is it's all captured on Parliament TV camera. You can all watch it. And if you want to see who is conducting this discussion about matters in our national affairs with dignity and who is not, that piece of TV shows that pretty clearly.
Thank you. Indeed. I wonder if we could start with an icebreaker question. And I wonder if I could go to Tate first. Tate, could you share with us what brings you trans joy?
Oh, very good question. Really simple things for me. Having my hair looking nice or my eyebrows looking thick, because before I transitioned, I was adamant that I was going to have really manly, bushy and dark eyebrows. So I think that it's the general sort of consensus there is it's the simple things for me, especially with my appearance and just being able to look in the mirror and see the man that I always knew that I was staring back at me.
Wow, that's brilliant. Robin.
Yeah, a couple of things. I mean, one area absolutely that echoes Tate's position is that I like to pass through society and not, in a sense, and not be noticed or be just accepted for who I am. The awful thing about having waited until my 40s before I transitioned is that people ask what it's like to be trans, and in a sense, you're lying every day. If you're a fundamentally honest person, you lie by your behaviour and your interaction with other people every day. And not to do that, and to actually forget the nasties. The general population of Britain understand trans people and have no difficulty with us fitting into society, which we do. And that's just a pleasure. The other thing that brings me joy, I work with law students a lot these days. Generation Z. I don't know what we're going to do after Generation Z. Do we have to start the letters again? I'm not sure. Somebody will tell me soon. And they get gender identity. And in fact, couldn't give a monkey's about gender identity generally, other than their own. And what it gives me, what gives me joy is to understand that the discussions that are causing trans people a lot of unhappiness at the moment, 20 years time, they'll be gone. And exactly the same way that the discussions about gay people have gone. I know that as Generation Z takes over, that acceptance of difference and variety will just increase and increase. And I can see that that would be so, and I'm so pleased about that.
Thank you. Shiva.
Thank you. I resonate so much with what's been said by Robin and Tate in terms of there's so much joy in the mundane, in the sense of, I mean, to be able to do things that I want to do without having my transness, my gender identity be a barrier or limiting factor, in the sense that there's so much effort, hypervigilance, hyper awareness of the self right from the moment that I walk out of the house, not knowing if I'm going to come back home safely, just to do something that I want to do, as simple as dancing. To be able to enter a space and dance without inhibition or worrying and doing all this extra mental gymnastics that one needs to do even before getting into a space to do what you want to do. I think having to drop that and just focus on what I'd like to do, which is the dance, would be a lot more relaxing, calming, and joyous. So I think, yeah, it's in the mundane of just getting by life and doing just the most basic things without having to be constantly reminded of how doing that there can be a barrier to it.
I wouldn't say that you should let every trans person enter a space and do what dancing they want to. It would be a bit of a disaster if it was me, but still.
Between the three of you, you've worked across a wide range of industries and a variety of different work settings. I guess one of the things that's really important to us is how do we create the best environment for people? I'd be really interested in your views. Could you share some experiences you've had from a supportive employer and what best practice looks like? And I wonder if I could ask Shiva to start with that.
Sure. I think having worked in very different industries, whether that's a corporate one, an entertainment one, or even within entertainment, whether it's a film one or a dance and performing arts one, my experiences have been very varied. And a lot of the times, the ways in which people speak about me and engage with me varies depending on which setting it is. So an example that sits with me a lot was I had done this event for a corporate company wherein I was invited to be part of, to speak on a panel. And me being me, I'm always ready for an opportunity to dress up and just like live that joyous gender euphoric lifestyle. And I was in this hyper feminine Indian outfit and just, yeah, living my best life. And I was there not realizing that sometimes you don't realize that even getting to a place, like just that transport in itself, can be very worrisome. And what I realized with that specific company was that they even before the event, had already asked me, how would you like to come to the event? Is there anywhere we can arrange your transport for you? And this is something that not many companies do, even for staff within employees within them. We talk a lot about safety within our organization, within the four walls of a setup of a building. But then what happens when you send someone of a specific gender identity and expression outside of your space into an offsite or an event outdoors? How are you looking after them? And that made me really feel seen but protected as well, in the sense they're looking after my safety, not just during the event, but before and after. So that was a very, was very healing in some sense. It was like, okay, I'm being looked after and taken care of. Another one I can think of was, we were at a work dinner. And I bring back these examples of, again, stepping out of the workspace, because our work doesn't end once we leave that four walls of an organization. It's how do you step up and ensure that you're continue to step up beyond the limitations of the four walls of an organization. And we were at a work event. It was a hotel, a gala dinner of fundraising event. And the toilets, there were no gender neutral toilets. And that can be a bit stressful and panicky for me sometimes, especially if I'm dressed in a certain way. And with no questions asked, my colleague, who is a straight man, just was like, I will come with you and look after you and I will stand there with you. Just such a simple thing of, you know, like being mindful of my discomfort, but also stepping up and without any worry of what, you know, just to stand up as an ally and be that protective barrier for me as well, was such a, it might have seemed very insignificant to a lot of people, but for me was huge, because I knew that I wouldn't be alone and that someone was there with me in case anyone else said anything, that I had support. And the fact that they were able to do that without me asking, and that was just by their own sort of onus, was very comforting. So these are some things that I think, just in general, how we can step up for one another beyond what is expected of us. So I think, yeah, those are some examples of how people have been supportive towards me in workspaces.
Thank you. It was really, really interesting. Tate, similar question, some experiences from supportive employers and what best practice looks like.
Yeah, so I've worked in law firms for around 5 years now, and for the most part, I've had a lot of positive experiences, and those have been where there's been a really positive culture that's been fostered within the organization. And what that looks like for me is a very active LGBT network that also has a global reach and does keep these conversations going all year round. When I started at Clifford Chance, where I spent most of the bulk of my career, I had come from a very unsupportive organization, and I wanted to go back into the closet. And I really felt like I didn't need to once I had arrived there, because their network was so active, and people that I'd spoken to in management made it very clear that actually I was going to be very safe and welcome here. And there was no need for me to go back into the closet. But on the flip side, there was no pressure for me to come out, because I was fully aware that I was their first out trans employee, but they didn't put that pressure on me and were very much led by me. And I think that's a lesson that a lot of organizations can take, is that you should be led by the trans person in their transition, in their journey, taking it in baby steps. And I absolutely love the example that Shiva gave there with that simple show of allyship. It doesn't need to be shouting and swearing and hollering at people. It can be simple gestures like that, or compliments. One of my favorite examples is where I did a lunch and learn in my workplace, and a lawyer I'd never met before emailed me afterwards and said, I also have a son whose name is Tate, and we named him Tate because it means full of spirit and full of life. May your life be as full of joy and spirit as our Tate's is. And I thought that was just such a lovely show of allyship. It didn't need to mention that I was trans. It didn't even need to mention about the lunch and learn. It was just saying, I see you and I appreciate you for who you are. And I think a kindness and love and solidarity, especially during this time, really goes a long way.
Absolutely. The word that came to mind was kindness, and you just, yeah, so absolutely recognise that. Robin.
Well, I'm a pretty specialist practitioner. I'm a pretty specialist discrimination practitioner. And there are probably a few hundred barristers that I interact with normally, and perhaps an even smaller number of judges that I interact with normally in my practice. And so that relationship is tremendously important. And I remember being in the East London, the Docklands Tribunal, not that long after I'd transitioned. And it is possible to do things with your voice, but it's risky if you're an oral advocate, and you can end up sounding like Minnie Mouse or whatever, and then no one's listening to your submissions. So I haven't done those things to my voice. I've stuck with my voice as it is. And I therefore have to acknowledge that I sound, if you look at me, I look fairly female, and nobody's generally very confused about how I present. But if you're listening to me, you have to think about it. And I was against another barrister who was cross-examining a witness and referring to things I had said in evidence with that witness, and misgendered me. And without hesitation, the judge intervened and said, no, you mean Ms. White. Oh, terribly sorry, said the barrister, and carried on. And then about 5 minutes later, did it again. And you could literally watch the judge turn the rheostat up to, you know, slightly tougher criticism of him for doing it for a second time. And he apologised and then moved on. And then about half an hour later, did it again. And the judge just paused and said, I wouldn't wish to get the impression that you were doing this deliberately, Mr. X. And he blushed from his ears to the roots of his hair. And that having the authority in the room defend you in that way, without having asked, without having said that it caused you difficulty, and to recognise that people will make mistakes about how they refer to you around transition, and you know, you should be generous to people who make those mistakes, but to be defended by authority in that way so early in my transition was really important to me, and I went home thinking, my profession have got it, my profession understand trans people. And that was more than a decade ago, and I still feel a slightly, you know, that slightly Weetabix glow that they do on the advert where the kids are on the way to school, and because they've eaten their Weetabix, they've got their glow around them. And it felt exactly like that. It felt like my profession were wrapping their arms around me. And that was tremendously important.
So I've spoken a little bit about intersectionality. And I guess, Shiva, you've mentioned the importance it's been implicit in everything you've said, really, in terms of the importance of intersectionality of your backgrounds, being Indian and a Hindu. Are there any areas of your life where you feel a clash between your gender identity and your cultural background?
Sure. So as I mentioned, I come from very different countries with very different experiences and vocabularies around transness, queerness, and each country that I've been in has their own laws as well about how we are not just able to speak about transness or even engage with transness, but experience transness. So language was already quite a conflicting thing with me growing up, in the sense, like, how do I put to words what I'm feeling on the inside when there are so many different ways in which what I think I am is being spoken about. And coming from a conservative family, conservative Hindu family in Indonesia, there was no room or opportunity to have these conversations and these discussions in an open, honest, authentic way, because A, we lacked access to information about it. We didn't have the kinds of visual representation that we could refer to and use as examples to identify with, nor were we allowed to, because the stereotypes around it, cultural stereotypes, but also local stereotypes around transness, was an inhibition. So right from the offset, we didn't have the vocabulary to address it. And so for me, what became easier was to tap into my Asianness. So my Asianness came to the forefront, having been from Asia. I was part of the majority because everyone else predominantly was Asian, had very similar experiences. It was only when I came to the UK that suddenly my Asianness was considered a minority and an other, and that then became questionable when my queerness came to the forefront, as I was able to speak about it and learn about it a lot more. And so there was this very weird disconnect in terms of I'm being seen as all of these different things, and it's everything, all these different identifiers of myself are so pronounced now in ways in which I didn't see before that. So I had to address and make peace with being Indian, being under the British Asian umbrella, but also the trans umbrella, being non-binary, and then with my profession. So all these different things suddenly didn't seem to merge well. And it's funny because in society, especially now, people tend to pick and choose which parts of your identity they want to focus on, or which seem profitable to speak about, or which seem more palatable to speak about or digestible to speak about. And so when all of these identities were presented as something that coexisted within me at all times, being experienced at every single point as I navigate life, I was made to feel that, ooh, I'm too complex to be understood, and thereby there was no room for me in spaces of my career profession, where in terms of media, there were less opportunities for someone who is queer and Asian. And so it was hard to fight for a space where all of these identities were honored, were seen and respected for what they are, and not be reduced as too complex or not commercially viable in these industries. So it was sort of trying to break that understanding and be okay with who I am and how I identify, and to see it not as a limiting factor, but as something that enriches my experience and brings to the table a perspective that isn't generally out there and readily accessible and available. And so it also meant a lot of introspection in terms of how do I see myself and make peace with all of these identities, because a lot of the things were projected onto me, in the sense people were like, oh, you can't be queer, you can't be non-binary and also a Hindu or religious, as though these things were not meant to sit together, which, fair enough, there are so many people who use religion to their advantage in terms of discriminating against people. But when I had the opportunity to look back and see that actually in Hinduism, transness is revered as a very divine existence, that I was able to make peace with it and also speak to the people around me in my circles, like family members and friends who used religion against me, in terms of trying to get them to understand that actually our own perspective has been skewed by the conditioning of people who want to weaponize these kinds of things against us. So how can we make room for ourselves as these holistic beings with whatever identities that we have to be seen as valid?
Yeah, no, I can see all of that. Are people inquisitive? Do they ask you questions about it and how it fits?
I love it when people are inquisitive. I think that people are very scared to ask questions out of the fear of saying something wrong or offending. And I'm like, if you come from a place that is genuine with the right intention of wanting to learn more in a positive way that will benefit you, I think, yes, ask questions. I'm very happy to answer those questions, because in that sense, we get to learn about one another, and in doing so, in sharing our stories, similarly to how we're doing today, we're all sharing stories, and there's so much power and harnessing the art of storytelling in bridging that gap and coming together and standing in solidarity with one another, because when we see each other as humans first and foremost, we can create that connection to appreciate how we are different as humans, but have such common goals in sort of fighting together in the good fights. I think I love talking about people and about myself and other people's experiences when asked. And I think we should encourage a culture where people can be curious and can ask questions that sometimes may seem uncomfortable. But again, it's sort of how do we facilitate those conversations in a way that doesn't A, harm the other person, or B, create an unsafe sort of environment. But again, we need conversation, we need dialogue, because only when we challenge one another, challenge our own perceptions and assumptions and stereotypes, can we unlearn a lot of things and progress.
Thank you. Tate. You are someone who was, I guess, initially socialized as a female prior to transition, and you've experienced what it's like to be perceived as both a woman and a man in the workplace. I'm really interested, what are the key differences you have noted in terms of how the genders are treated differently in the workplace?
Well, respect is a really big one. I immediately command respect when I walk into a room now as male, whereas when I used the interspace as presenting female, my worth was based on, my attractiveness level. You know, as soon as I enter a space now, especially when there's another man, it would be, you're all right, Tate, how are you? You know, they want to be your best mate, they want to get to know you. Whereas when I walked in presenting female, it's that 5 second, do I find you attractive or not? And then I'm gonna judge how I speak to you based on that. And as a legal secretary as well, I get asked a lot why I'm a legal secretary, which I never got as presenting female, because I guess being a male legal secretary is different enough in itself, but obviously being a trans male legal secretary, but I find myself having to ask a lot of questions and people presuming that I'm gay, or, you know, I somehow failed whatever courses I was doing. And so those sorts of questions have been really interesting to navigate. But I guess the big things would be the male privilege that comes with me just simply looking like a man now. I mean, I've touched upon respect there, but what I found is that my opinions and my ideas are valued a lot more than women's in a meeting, for example. So I could give an idea or suggest something, and a woman could say the exact same thing, but I'll be listened to more. People will take on more what I'm saying, and that's not okay. You know, my opinion should not be valued more simply because I'm a man. And I have seen this all throughout my nearly 4 year transition, and I'm very well aware of it. And the way that I do that is I use my privilege to speak up and give a platform to those women and say, and this is not okay, and call in that behavior rather than call it out and make a big hoo-ha about it in the meeting room. I can say what you did there was not okay, and here's why. Because it's so much more effective to call people in on that behavior and educate so they can learn from it, and then they can call that behavior out too. But it really has been fascinating. And I mean, I'm coming to the end of my transition now, because it's like a second puberty, so 5 years. So I'm 4 out of 5 years now. And I mean, even with my public speaking, I actually forget that I'm trans day to day. So for me, I'm looking now to growing as Tate, growing as a man, because that is who I am first and foremost. But what's funny is that I'm not nitpicking on the changes that have been happening to me. I'm actually starting to think more about the societal changes that I've seen presenting female as opposed to presenting male, especially in the workplace. And my intention is to keep using that male privilege for the better.
Robin, you've heard those two answers about different aspects of intersectionality. I wonder if you've got any thoughts on what you've heard.
I think it's fascinating, and I was particularly interested in Tate's perspective because, of course, in the sense I've moved in the opposite direction. And I early on noticed things about body language, for example, where in Western culture, two women would touch each other or interact with each other in a very different way than two men would, or a man and a woman. And I had to get used to those things. I had a very traditional family upbringing. I had great parents, but they weren't particularly accepting of difference. And it took my parents a very long time to work through acceptance of me as a trans person. And ultimately they came to it. They watched me struggle with trans for many years. And something completely outside their experience, and came to accept it. And I have seen other people go through that loop very much more quickly and very much more easily. And what I've understood is that if you want to retain people as a friend, a proportion of people will struggle with trans, because it something that's completely fundamental to someone's makeup, trans people challenge, and particularly trans women say the thing that men are supposed to value above all other things, we don't value. And that, I know, is very threatening to a slice of male society. And if we are to fit in and be accepted for who we are, then my view is that we have to understand that struggle that other people will have. And it doesn't mean to say that we should accept inappropriate behaviour, but we should understand the psychological difficulties potentially that trans people cause for other people. And the easier that we can make that, and the more time we can spend explaining the position, being out there and doing what we're doing today, then the better we're going to do.
Thank you. Robin, rather than asking Shiva to answer the first question every time, it seems a little bit unfair. I'm going to be a little bit more unfair to you now. A personal question, really. As somebody who's an ally and is permanently trying to be a better ally, I wonder if there was one thing that you could say to people like me who want to be good allies, one thing that we could do to help that you don't see us doing often enough. I'd be really interested in what that one thing would be.
Sorry, is that for me or for Shiva?
Sorry, Robin, that was for you first.
Zero tolerance. I'm afraid to say that we have moved in the last few years into an area where in poor treatment of trans people has become acceptable by the media, by politicians. I mean, if you watch the, and this is absolutely, you know, please don't get any view as to my political views, but we watched the Conservative leadership competing, candidates competing to be unpleasant to trans people. Now, that's appalling. It's also going to be destructive, because we can see that actually most people are more interested in how they're going to pay the food and the electricity bill than what's going to happen with trans people. And because certain politicians don't have an answer to the food bill or the electricity bill problem, then they'd rather run a culture war. It would be lovely to see more allies stand up and say, why are you doing this? Why are you weaponizing a minority community? And when you do that, we don't like you. We don't like what you're doing, and we are less likely to vote for you. And the more people who don't apparently have skin in the game who say that, the less likely the quicker that will fade away, because it will fade away. And it would be nice to see more allies standing up and saying this is unacceptable behaviour.
Yeah, I absolutely get that. Tate, if there was one thing that an ally, allies could do more of or differently?
I think to tail on to the back of that amazing answer is please challenge people. I think simply asking, why have you said that? Why do you think that? Why are you sensationalizing trans women using the bathroom of their choice? I see people get very uncomfortable, especially adults, when you say, why have you said that? Because then they go, oh, and then it makes them think. It's just challenging, even in a polite way. And it's really going to make people think twice about why they do think the way that they do. And I think, unfortunately, a lot of the responses that we're seeing and these learned behaviours are coming from this manufactured moral panic coming from anti-trans headlines. And I see it filtering down into society and everyday conversation where people are now asking me on my view on trans swimmers and trans women using the bathrooms when nobody has a problem with me using the men's bathroom. So
I'm sorry to jump back in. And there's an example from popular culture, and I use a lot of popular culture when answering this. Many people will have seen the film about the computers at NASA, the black women who worked to do the calculations that got the American space shots. What was that film called? Anyway.
Was it Hidden Figures?
Hidden Figures. Thank you very much. I always struggle with remembering the name of the film. And the Kevin Costner character who takes the double jack to the black women's bathroom sign. It's an obvious. Now, you know, you watch that and the horror is that was within our lifetime. And yet that is happening to trans people daily.
A brilliant example. And I think that really just demonstrates how much of an issue this has become for our community, and it really does impact people day to day. So I think to any attendees with us today, please be aware of these conversations that are being held and think about trans people simply living and accessing your workplace, because these are things, simple things, just wanting to go for a wee, just wanting to grab some tissue from the bathroom, going into some changing rooms. We're probably more scared of you than you think you might be of us. And then you have to think, well, why are you scared? Is it because the headlines are making you think so? So please, I think the one thing obviously from that is to challenge people, but the general consensus is to please educate yourself beyond the headlines, which obviously is the title of this session. Even if it is just looking at terms on Stonewall Glossary, or attending more webinars like these, continue to educate yourself, because knowledge is power. And if we all collectively come together to support trans people being a minority, then we can wash this negativity away. I'm sure we'll be able to get there.
Thank you. So zero tolerance is very powerful. Knowledge is very powerful. Shiva, what would you add?
Yes,
for allies?
Probably an extension of what's been said, but we all, no matter who we are, we spend a lot of time consuming media, whether that's through the news, through our phones, doom scrolling on social media. I think what we can all very easily do is check what kind of media we're consuming, and how can we diversify our feeds, whether it's your LinkedIn feed, whether it's your Facebook feed, whether it's your Twitter or Instagram, or even the kinds of news outlets you look at. Because I think the ways in which we individually curate the kind of informations we consume, it also informs how the algorithm works for you. And it's sort of, again, down to what is that media? What's the information? What's the knowledge? What's the news? Who is giving you that news, media, information and knowledge? Because it's very evident that the kinds of narratives, people who take up all that space have a very anti-trans rhetoric nowadays, which has taken over sort of trans narratives, narratives that don't even come from trans people. And so trans people are living all sorts of lives beyond what is being shown outside of violence and trauma, beyond, as we've said, beyond the headlines, and that we aren't a monolith. So make us part of your daily lives in a very intentional way. Seek out trans people of different backgrounds, different cultures, different experiences, different professions. Follow them and make them part of your feed, because then as soon as they become part of your daily experience, you become more sensitive, more aware of how they speak about themselves, about their experiences, so that you are better aware of what their challenges are, also what their joys and wins are. Because I think then that makes us, that builds that empathy within ourselves in a very subconscious and very like strong, it sits with us. Because if we're part of your daily lives in a way that's healthy, then you automatically have more room to engage with trans people's and trans people's narratives. Because again, media has such a massive impact on its audiences. As we've said, they inform culture, they challenge norms, they shape our attitudes, behaviors, they reflect culture, but also what we see on screen in our medias, it informs how we engage with those people in society, because it trickles down. And so seeing imageries of positive imageries of trans people living their lives can really be not just life affirming for them because you're engaging with them, but also can be very educational for yourselves. So I think, and that will translate in how you can then step up as an ally, because then it'll feel easier because you've already been accustomed to their narratives in a way that they would like to be seen. So I think one very easy thing is look at your feeds. Where is your information coming from? And just get more, get better.
Mm. Yeah, and I have a tiny illustration about the educate yourself. I mean, I'm a binary trans person. I made a very binary choice about my gender. But I picked up some non-binary clients over the last few years, particularly after having done the Jaguar and Taylor and Jaguar Landrover case. And we noticed that our system in chambers couldn't send an invoice to MX anyone. It just didn't have the facility. And so we spoke to our software providers, who said, "Well, we'd never thought about that." And an engineer over the weekend rewrote the code slightly, and by Monday morning there was MX available to us on the drop-down box where you chose how to address the invoice. And in fact, we got a very nice note back from the software company that said that they, in fact, rolled it out across the other chambers who used the same software, and had really positive feedback from other chambers that said, "Thank you very much. Thank you for being diversity forward." And just by, you know, our computer says no, and taking a look at something, and then being able to respect a client appropriately in the way that we issued something as simple as issuing an invoice.
Thank you. Tate, I wonder if I can ask you, how can gender and LGBTQIA plus networks, how can those two networks work together to support trans people, trans colleagues in the workplace, do you think?
Well, I think a simple way of doing that would be sort of arming forces to respond to things like Gender Recognition Act reform. I know I've seen workplaces where the two networks have come together to sign open letters, to host webinars, to host talking discussions and open forum groups within organisations. I definitely think there's a lot of crossover, especially if you think about it as a Venn diagram, but women's issues and gender parity also affects trans women, and I think that's really important to know. So I think the two networks really have to work side by side and form that relationship and to respond to things together.
Shiva, do you have a view on that same question?
Sorry, could you repeat that again?
Yeah, how can the gender and LGBTQIA groups, networks within society, I guess, as well as business. How can they work together to help trans colleagues?
One thing that I've realized, and over the work that I've done with the different kinds of network groups, is that often they see them, what they see that their, whatever their fight is done separately in silos, and that in fact, there's a lot of overlap in the kinds of things that they're trying to achieve in terms of access, in terms of creating a level playing field for people of irrespective of their gender, in terms of how that shouldn't be a limiting factor. So I think when there is an understanding that actually we are fighting for very similar causes, it becomes easier to find common goals to work towards. And I think that is great in terms of stepping up for one another so that they can step up together for them as a collective as well. So that's something that I've realized works really well in terms of understanding why we are here and what we need from the network and how can we achieve that together because we're stronger with the numbers.
Thank you. Robin, we've got somebody who says that they've shared they believe that Generation Alpha follows Generation Z. I'm not sure whether that's right or not, but they have asked a question specifically. They wanted your view in terms of, are there practical ways in which allies can support trans people either personally or professionally? I guess the professional bit might be slightly different, but practical ways that they're really interested in your views on what people can do to help.
I mean, in a sense, I mean, we're coming to the end of our hour as well. And in a sense, all trans people want is to be treated appropriately, respected for who they are and what they can do and how they can bring value to an organization and what they know and what their experience and background is, without being distracted by the irrelevant. And isn't that what everyone wants? And if you just look past the irrelevant to what the individual knows and can do and brings, what value they bring to the organization, ultimately that's all we want. And it's not such a big ask, is it?
No, it's really not. We've had several questions about what does transitioning actually mean, or questions related to that. I wonder if we could use that question to think about differences in terms of transitioning socially, medically, at work, and talk about experiences in terms of changes to your appearance, for example, because we seem to have lots of questions about this. Shiva, would you mind answering that first?
Yeah, sure. Also, just side note, I was trying to think of what that example was when we were talking about the networks coming together. One very salient example is, for example, if you have International Women's Day, that's something that both networks can come together and work towards together. So that's a very, very real, tangible example. Sorry, transitioning. Transitioning is whatever that means to you, whatever that looks like to you, whatever that feels like to you. It's a very individual process, experience, and there's no like fixed sort of timelines to it. We are not a monolith. We don't have the very same experience. Oftentimes we're lumped into, this is what being trans is, this is what being trans looks like. Often that is not the case. And so it's making room for whatever that means to that individual person and respecting that, so that our own perceptions of transness expands beyond what we think is very definitive or rigid in terms of that experience. For myself, it meant changing my pronouns. It meant not seeing myself within a rigid binary of male and female. It meant wearing clothes. I think in essence, it just meant degendering a lot of my experiences because of how highly gendered my experiences were, whether it's, for example, entering a dance studio to dance. I would be forced to do either a male choreography or a female choreography, which was very bizarre to me because I just wanted to do choreography. That's the very easiest way I can explain it, in the sense that I just wanted to dance without it having to be labeled as any specific gender. And a lot of that is how I navigate life, in the sense I do not see myself wearing female clothes or male clothes. I'm just wearing clothes. And so it's reassessing the ways in which I spoke about myself and the experiences in which I felt didn't speak to me, and seeing where I fit in that. And if I didn't, then how do I create space for myself in that? So that's what it had to mean for me. And so it's sort of not, and I feel like it was, in a sense, gaining this label, this identity of what non-binary is, but also finding community within that, in the sense that there were so many people within the non-binary umbrella who felt that, who were made to feel like they're not, should they identify under the trans umbrella, that they weren't trans enough, that they weren't non-binary enough, and they had to constantly challenge themselves in terms of what that actually meant. But when we realize that oftentimes we're trying to attach markers of identity based on what is easier to understand for the other person rather than what is easier to understand for us, that then the penny dropped and clicked, that actually we don't need to explain ourselves in the sense of why our existence and experiences are valid, that it already is because we are here and doing it. So that has been my sort of mental transition as well, in terms of coming into my non-binary identity.
Tate, how can we support our trans colleagues without stepping up into their space when speaking about trans issues? Is one of the questions that's got a lot of likes. So how can we support our trans colleagues without stepping up into their space when speaking about trans issues?
That's a very, very thoughtful question, actually. I guess when you're in the workplace, you want to give that platform to trans people to speak about issues. And I guess you don't want to be speaking about issues that are integral to them and things that impact their daily lives if you're not trans. But that being said, you obviously want to give that platform to allow them to share those experiences. I guess, in short, just don't speak on their behalf unless they want you to. I think I find it really patronizing when people start saying, oh yeah, well, I'm supportive of trans people because I know X, Y, and Z, just like when somebody comes out as gay and they go, well, I'm accepted of gay people because, you know, my uncle is gay. I think there's much more positive ways you can show allyship. But you obviously want to be able to express your thoughts in a safe manner. And the way that you can do that is by continuing those conversations, but by allowing trans people to have the forefront of those conversations. Please don't speak on their behalf and really tread around some topics that they may be bringing into the conversation or the workplace, and making sure that you're giving them that platform to bring those issues to light.
I think there's one, I just jump in and say there's one exception to that, which is that it's enormously important for organisations to be seen to buy into ED&I at a very senior level. And there are times when it's appropriate for the chief exec of the company, for example, to be the person making the statement. And obviously, who knows what personal characteristics that chief exec is going to have. And they need to buy in what characteristics they have or don't have. But following Tate's point, one of the most powerful presentations I've seen is by Network Rail, where their chief exec, Andy Haynes, was speaking about inclusion and used his slot to introduce someone else to talk about a particular aspect of EDI. And so you got both aspects. You got endorsement by the chief exec and you got direct personal experience from the individuals concerned. And if you can achieve that, then you're a very long way along the road to showing that you value every last person who works for your company.
Thank you. Robin, I'd like to ask this one to you. The question is, and it's anonymous, but it's got a lot of likes. All of the guests are powerful role models. Thank you. How do you manage the challenge of balancing your activism with your own self-care?
You have to, I think there are times when you have to step back. And I do this particularly, I have probably 20 or 30 really good friends who are as closely involved in some of the matters as I am. And I'm open enough with them that they can email me and say, how are you? How is this affecting you? Or just directly pick the phone up when something particularly unpleasant happens. I mentioned the experience in the Women Inequality Select Committee in the Commons on the 31st of January. And those 10 of those 20 or so people were in touch with me the very same evening and formed the safety valve that allowed me to work out how to react appropriately to that circumstance. And I think, you know, trust your friends, pick the right friends, build your network, and trust your friends. That's what I do. That's what works for me.
Thank you, Robin. Shiva, how do you find confidence in dressing for your work life in a way that you feel comfortable? The person asking the question says personally they feel it can be quite binary and difficult.
Thank you for that question. Thank you for thinking that there's confidence oozing here, but it is a constant battle. It's a constant thing that I have to navigate in terms of choosing myself over what the alternative would be. And I think it's, again, down to how safe you feel to be able to do it in terms of the context, the surrounding, and what that means to you, what it serves, how it serves you. Because I think as soon as you center yourself first, things can get a bit more easier. And so I'm still discovering it. I'm still trying to see how best to stand up for my own self in certain situations. So I think it's a learning journey for myself as well. And I think it doesn't need to be, there's pockets of joy to find when you do that for yourself. So I think it doesn't need to be as linear as I'm super confident now and this is it. You can have moments of doubt and fear, but it's, again, that intention. What does this mean to you? Is it important? Do you want to stand up for yourself? Can you stand up for yourself? Do you have the support systems? Do you have people who can support you and stand by you for that? So I think you don't have to do it on your own, basically. Look at the ways in which other people are doing it. Find support from people who've come before us, people around us who are doing it. There's so much access to support if you'd like. So it's sort of like not feeling like you're doing this on your own and alone. That's how I've managed to do it, seeing other people, finding strength from other people doing it for themselves. And I think that informs how I channel that into my practice. So yeah, it's whatever you want it to be, and it doesn't need to be that difficult should you choose.
Thank you.
It can be messy, is all I'm saying. It can be messy. It doesn't need to be that, like, play with it, have fun. Have fun with gender. I feel like, yeah, it doesn't need to be that strict.
I get it. That's perfect. Thank you. We've got around, I think we're due to finish at 2:15. So probably I'd like to ask one final question to all three of our panelists. And this is one that's got, again, a lot of thumbs up. So people are really interested. Robin, if it's OK, I'll start with you. What advice would you give to a trans person who has not yet come out in the workplace or socially transitioned that is considering to do so?
It's a very personal choice. So do it when you're ready. Don't feel rushed into transitioning. If we're focused on the workplace, and let me go slightly into lawyer mode for a moment, find the most senior person that you're comfortable to interact with in the workplace, either in the management chain or within HR, and go and talk to them as early as you can in the process, because that's what brings you, frankly, the legal protections that we grant trans people. So until you've declared that intention to your employer, you're not protected, and from the moment you are, you are. And that should trigger some help. I get at least once a month, I get via my clerks a request to speak to the senior management of a company who've suddenly got a trans person in their company and they haven't thought about that beforehand. And that's been triggered because the trans person has declared themselves. So do that. And on a personal level, there's a lot of nastiness going on about trans at the moment, generated, and I was pleased to hear in the discussion, generated by some very vocal, but actually tiny numbers of people. And my experience as a trans person who's been out there for a long while now is that 98.9% of people are helpful and supportive and respectful and will give you all the help that you need.
Thank you, Robin. Tate, can I ask you the same question?
I would just echo the bit about doing it when you're ready, and it is a very, very personal choice, and you want to do it when you're confident enough to do so, and most importantly, in a safe enough space. My journey to my transition was very, very tricky. I came out when I was 16, and then I had to go back into the closet for 2 years because my family did not support me, and they still don't support me. So I had to prepare to have my own support network in place. And I would highly advise you do so as well, if that's just chosen family, your biological family, a group of friends, your LGBT network at your workplace, if you feel confident enough to do so. Perhaps there's somebody that can become a sort of buddy to you that can help you through your transition. And if you feel confident enough and comfortable to do so, possibly share that with your line manager and look at what that transition is going to look like for you and think about a care plan in place, but also your self-care as well. This is a really, really exciting time transitioning, and it's a big decision to make. And well done that you're about to make it, and I really hope it goes well for you. But make sure that you think about your self-care and taking time to just be you, engage in your hobbies and your interests, and make sure your brain and your body is ready for these exciting changes that will happen with your social transition.
Shiva.
I would say, no matter where you are on that journey of transition, whatever you wish that to be, your transness is valid, is beautiful, and one whose explanation you don't owe to anyone. You set those parameters, you set those definitions for yourself. There's a community, yes, as mentioned, a chosen family ready to support you out there, but choosing your existence, choosing your joy, that is radical, and that is resistance. That is resistance in itself, and there's so much power to find in that transness. So yeah, there's lots of love to be found.
Thank you so much. And thank you to all three of our panelists who've been amazing today. The feedback which we can see on Slido is truly beautiful and very kind. So lots of congratulations to all three of you for making such a difference today. I have written so many notes today. Robin's zero tolerance for allies. I absolutely get that, and I take that as a personal challenge from here on in. I think Tate's story of being treated more seriously as a man than a woman is one of the most sobering things that I can possibly imagine hearing. In a horrible way, it makes sense, but it is in a really horrible way, and it's an incredibly powerful story. And Shiva, those things you were talking about earlier on in terms of going to an event and safety on the way and safety when you were there, not just in the room, is equally something I've written down and make sure that we pick up. And we are more intentional in what we do, because it's easy sometimes to focus on a small space and not everything that surrounds it. So thank you, everybody, for listening. Thank you, Shiva. Thank you, Tate. And thank you, Robin. I thank you for your insight and spending time with us. Thank you so much, and have a good rest of your day.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, everyone.